And now, coming to you from the Pensado Media Center, powered by Westlake Pro.
How to get a great vocal from one of the best in the space. Indaba winners announced, Avid Westlake Pro Remix Contest is rocking, PA4 updates, and a brand new ITL. You're at the place, it's Pensado's place.
Yeah.
Hey, great to be back home. We've been globetrotting, and good to be home, isn't it?
Woo, it is.
Yeah.
I like that little sound.
Well, you know, Ray taught me about how to modulate your voice, you know, to win elections and stuff.
So that was Williams.
Yeah. So that was my attempt to go up an octave.
Oh, I see. So you can win a presidential election.
You found it more charming, though, didn't you?
I did. I thought it made you warm and fuzzy.
Yeah,
shall we go ahead?
Oh, God, please.
Okay. We'll hey, gang, as you can tell, there's a lot going on, and we've been traveling, so we're punch drunk. Thanks for your likes and subscribes. Much appreciated. Yeah. Tip of the cap to these folks. 1,500 or nothing. The Blackbird Academy, Westlake Pro, Avid, Heaviosity, NAM, Lander, and Fab Factory. As Dave alluded to in the Globetrotting, we just want to say thanks to Ray Williams, Nadia Adams, the whole team up in Toronto. Treated us incredibly well, had their largest IMSTA Festa ever. If you have an IMSTA Festa near you, go. You're gonna learn a lot of stuff, a lot of things, and you know, some friends of yours who's got a show called Pensado's Place might be bringing some panels to it. Great time, also a really good AES. We're in New York, so to all the folks we met with and shook hands and took a bit. So anyways, just wanted to make sure we acknowledge that. We've got some winners. Dave P has done his thing on the Indaba Mix Contest. Were you impressed with what you got?
Of course. Yeah.
You put some time in. You put some time in while we were traveling.
I know.
I think we should announce some winners. All right, we're getting ready to announce. Chongo's going to help me with the drum roll. You're going to do the big announcement. Here we go. And the second runner-up is?
M-Co.
M-Co. Congratulations, M-Co. Well done. All right, here we go. We got to do another one. And let's get ready for the first runner-up. The drum roll, please. This one's a good one. And the first runner-up is?
Jop Vanderkline,
well done. And now the big one. Okay, bigger drum roll, Tom's. And the grand prize winner is?
Lehigh. Good job, everybody.
All right,
good
congratulations,
job.
Everybody. Dave says good job. And let's go to Johnny. Johnny, what did they win?
They win a bunch of prizes.
Like what?
You got a Skype appearance on Pensado's Place, great gear from Tascam, Isotope, Beat Skills, Lander, just so many things. Just congrats to all you guys.
Okay, great. And I think we're going to arrange for somebody to be on the show, right?
Yeah, we got a Skype.
Lehigh is going to be on the show and other kinds of stuff. So congratulations to you guys. Congratulations to all the companies that are supportive. Indaba always does a great job. But we're not done. So keep those mixing chops up and going, because our folks at Avid and Westlake Pro, they've got the Butterscotch We Are All We Got Remix Contest. Good stuff. You can see it behind it. You can enter at the link you see below me and take your shot at all this stuff. I think what we want to do, let's get Butterscotch on next week.
Yeah.
She'll do a little piece and talk about the thing, because she does a real cool singing and rap thing. She's a very attractive lady.
Yeah.
So we'll have them on. Johnny, what kind of prizes do they have for this contest?
Johnny's back with more prizes this time.
Okay, Johnny.
We got Pro Tools, Westlake Pro gift cards, interfaces, keyboards. We got
Johnny. Where did I get Johnny?
Any more of that, I'm leaving.
But Johnny's a good prize winner. Keep going,
Johnny. We got stuff from Isotope, 0802, another Skype appearance on Pensado's Place. We got a lot of stuff you guys are going to love.
So
actually, that was pretty good, Johnny.
Very good. Johnny did well. So enter the link below. You see it right there. Avid and Westlake Pro, two powerhouse companies hooking up to make sure good stuff happens for you. We'll be the first of many. Butterscotch is a real cool thing. Obviously, there's a distinction between a mix that you just do something with, and then a remix, which requires a lot more of your creativity. So do your thing. Correct, DP?
Yes.
We'll be judging and announcing that in about three or four weeks. Good stuff. The PA4s are on fire. We've got the host set. We've got great companies that are supporting. The nominations are in. Ticket sales are moving. You can go to the link, get yours there, and get them quickly. 5 or 6 weeks out, and we're going to be banging. Brought to you by a host of the great companies we just saw, all of our great title sponsors, and especially by 1500 Nothing. Speaking of them, you know, they do a lot of different things. They got songwriters and producers, and they're a band, and they've got an education component we're going to be sharing with you. Just to give you a little sense of what's going on, Rance, who's the CEO of the company, is a musical director for Jay-Z, got called last minute to go out on tour. We'll show you a little bit of what he has to deal with. Roll that, Chongwa. Songs or 46 songs in 48 hours or something crazy like that. Amazing. These are super talented guys. We're going to have fun introducing you to them. They just amaze us. What also amazes us are these wonderful ITLs that Dave's done. What do you got this week for us, sir?
Oh, man. You know, I really had a great time chatting with Jessica Lynn, up-and-coming singer-songwriter. And we talked about how she uses the Tascam Track Factory, which I was very impressed with.
Oh,
check
cool.
it out.
Let's roll it.
Hey, Jessica, good to see you again. that's my championship acting skills. We were talking earlier, and by the way, we're talking with Jessica Lynn, who is rapidly becoming a favorite of mine. What were some of the early problems that you felt in terms of how the process was affecting your creativity, and how did you come to solve those problems? I know you get offered a lot of equipment and stuff in terms of your band and yourself.
Well, as just a singer-songwriter, not a producer or an engineer, it was always very frustrating to me when I had a song idea or lyrics or something or guitar riff and I needed to get it down, and I always had to ask for help to get the recording studio up and running and to get plugged in. And then, you know, by the time the 20 minutes goes by, you plugging everything and finding your mics and all that, sometimes your spark is gone. And that's what's so cool about something like the Track Factory, that you can get an idea and then get it down right away, and you don't need to rely on anybody else for it. But to speak to your point about being offered equipment and things, I've been really lucky to be touring the last few years and have 2 shows on television. And my band and I get offered a lot of stuff, like, hey, can you play this guitar in your television special? Or, you know, can you sing in this microphone? And I think it's so important as an artist to only take on products and things that you're truly passionate about. And the same for a company. You don't want somebody repping your stuff that doesn't really believe in it or use it. And Tascam is just an incredible company. And I think that every singer-songwriter, the average singer-songwriter like me, can truly benefit from having something so easy to use that can really help your creativity run and not be stifled.
How did you solve the problem?
Well, I started working with Tascam this year. I was actually introduced to them at NAMM in California,
okay,
which is one of my favorite places to go. I mean, it's just so cool that you can be in one place with musicians and people that love music and understand music from all around the world. And they had told us about this amazing new system that they had called the Track Factory. And it's pretty much a recording studio in a box. And I don't say that lightly. It literally is that.
And so with your massive and newfound engineering skills, it was... did it fit your skill set?
Well, the thing that was so awesome about it, and I was skeptical when he said, oh, I got this great new thing and it's really so easy. I was like, okay, we'll see. And I literally was able to set it up in a matter of minutes without reading any instructions. And I'm I swear to that. I actually hate reading instructions, anything. If I have to put together a table or, I mean, anything, literally, I will sit there for hours and try to do it before I will pick up that book. It's just the most frustrating thing to me. And I, not knowing anything about how to set up a recording studio, I literally took every piece out of the box, assembled it, and was up and running within 15 minutes.
That's pretty cool. So that's extremely cool. So the it's not just one thing, it's an entire package, complete, everything you need, headphones, microphone, a little computer, headphones, did I say headphones? Everything you need, just plug it in and go. What do you use for a monitor?
I actually use my television as a monitor. when I'm, as long as it has an HDMI, because you need a mini HDMI cable out of the little Nook computer that it comes with by Intel, and you can just hook it up to any monitor. And I think it's really cool to kind of just sit on my couch in my living room and set it all up on the coffee table and have this nice big like recording studio monitor in front of me. But it's really been a blessing for someone like me. And that was the first time I ever put it together by myself. It took about 15 minutes. I bet now that I'm kind of a whiz at it, I could do it in like
don't get cocky.
5 to 7 minutes.
Don't get cocky now. You're not going to set up a shingle and like start mixing, are you?
No, I don't think so. Okay.
Man, technology has come such a long way. The track factory just solves so many problems and sounds so good. Real quick, we both have a history with Tascam in our past. How did you come? I heard you talking something about your dad introduced you to some Tascam gear back in the day. Mine was an 80-8.
Wow. When I was a kid, about 10 years old, my dad gave me a little 4-track Tascam cassette recorder. I think it was called the Mini Studio, the one that we had. And I remember clearly, like it was yesterday, recording my very first songs on that thing. Learning to play guitar and trying to figure out how the riffs that I was thinking would go over the chords that I was putting down and throwing harmonies in. And then when I got a little bit older, I graduated to the 8-track, which was so exciting. And I actually had it on a little childhood type of table, the little mini table and chair sets right in my bedroom. So I would just sit in there for hours and learn how to record and put music together. And that's so special to me because really music is a journey. Even now I'm constantly on this journey of evolving and learning new things and new gear and new products that can help me get better and grow as an artist. And to still be with Tascam after all these years and to have them along with me for that journey is something that I think is so, so special.
Yeah, it's a good company. There's not a whole lot of companies in audio that you can just trust the name and buy whatever they make and be happy. And Tascam's certainly at the top of my list. So going back to the track factory, the microphone, the headphones, all those you found to be good quality? I mean, great quality?
Really good. And everything was just in the box. Like, it was so, so, so easy. One thing I hate is kind of running around the house like, oh, where did I put that cable, you know, that XLR or whatever? And I really am not exaggerating where you take it out, plug it in, and you are up and rolling. And one of my favorite things, too, that I didn't even realize until I was using it recently, they even have all the international adapters for it. In wow. The box already.
Right.
And I was like, how cool is this? When I was overseas for 2 months this summer touring, and we were in 6 different countries, how cool is it that if I bought the Track Factory along and needed to record, I can easily, right in that box again, just pull out whatever I needed and get going.
The Track Factory uses DAWs, and there's quite a wide variety that it uses. Which one is the DAW that you prefer?
Sonar. I've been using Sonar ever since I was a little kid. That's what my dad always used. So that's what I learned to use as I grew up. And I knew it at a very, very basic level. As I said, I always kind of needed help getting set up. But it was really, really cool that I was able, literally, like I said, to just plug in and start using it myself. I didn't even need any help setting up the program at all because it's so cool. It pops up on your TV or whatever monitor you're using. You click Sonar and you're literally in and ready to record as long as you hit the record button.
And do you ever notice any latency of any kind, all of those types of things that seem to plague other systems like this? There's no latency on this.
No, I had literally not a single problem using it. Even on the top right-hand corner in the program in Sonar, right when you open it up, actually last night I was playing around with it, there's a ton of drum loops in there. There's even auto-tune in it, backing tracks. Even for someone that just wants to grow as a player, I mean, you could easily set this up, like I said, in 5 minutes, plug yourself in, record practice over any type of, they have pop backing tracks, blues, country, ballads, fast songs. I mean, anything that you could ever want was literally right there at your fingertips, and all you had to do was click on it to get going.
Sounds like this is a creative tool more than a technical tool for you, right?
Definitely.
Listen, so you highly recommend it, right?
I do, if you couldn't tell.
I've been touring the last several years, and I'm really at a very happy place right now in my career, and I've worked really, really hard to get here. And I think that it's really, I totally forgot where I was just going with that. I had such a good point, and now I forgot.
Well, I got a good point for you. Where can people find you, and how can they get in touch with you?
Well, my website is jessicalynnmusic.org, and I'm on Facebook and YouTube and all that stuff, too. Usually, if you search Jessica Lynn Music or Jessica Lynn Country in Google, you can find anything.
JessicaLynn.
Yes.
.com.
Listen, I'm so mad I forgot my point.
Well, I forgot your name, so we're even.
So we're even.
Well, we'll just have to do this again, okay?
Okay.
All right, sweetheart. Listen, thanks so much. It's a pleasure talking to you, and good luck. Can't wait to hear your stuff. I'm going to get off here and go to your website and check some things out.
Simply the best in the business, multi-hyphenate. Songwriter, producer, composer, friend, parent. Today's a very special day for him. If you want to know about vocals, you're about to find out. We'll welcome through our magic little box here the one, the only, Kuk Harrell.
Kuk.
Thank you, my friend.
What up, man? Let's say right off the top, today is your anniversary. How many years?
Yeah, 25.
25 years. So please tell Stevie not to kill us when she sees us.
Exactly.
Because we're interrupting your day. Congratulations. You know, we've gotten,
thank you, man. Appreciate
gotten to know
it.
The family and stuff. And the one thing that I think is interesting, because as much as you work and travel, I also know the fact that you keep a life-work balance so that doesn't get out of control. Is that fair?
Absolutely. 100%. Yep.
Does it make your work better?
It actually does, because I find that when I come back home and I'm doing family, it's actually, even though I'm, you know, doing stuff here and around the house and, you know, taking care of the kids and my wife and all that kind of stuff, it's refueling me. It's recharging me to go back into what I do, as opposed to, like, when I was younger, we just lived in the studio. So there was no retreat. You know, it was like you're there all night, you're there all day, you go home, take a shower, whatever, come back, and you're back at it. But you don't really get a chance to kind of step away and just, refresh your mind, refresh your heart, refresh your spirit, just recharge your being, so that when you go back into it, you go back into it and it's still enjoyable.
And it, you know, we talked about this in New York. You have to refresh your ears, refresh your objectivity.
Yep. Right? Absolutely.
Right? Is that fair to say?
No.
Oh, okay, thanks.
I just stay there.
So, everybody watching, throw all that out. And it just, give me a definition, Kuk. The difference, because I know that people sometimes get this confused, there's a difference between being a vocal coach and being a vocal producer, correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
Define it?
Yeah, So in my opinion, the difference between a vocal coach and a vocal producer, the vocal coach focuses on, the way I break it down, they focus on all the technical things that have to do with the voice, teaching you how to sing properly, teaching you things about working out, making sure you warm up your vocal cords before you actually sing, making sure you sing from the diaphragm, how you stand, how you sit, all that stuff. It's all the technical things. But as a vocal producer, our main responsibility is focusing on the feeling, focusing on the vibe of what the record should be. So there are a lot of times that there's things that we could be singing that really, you know, in a way, it's not really technically proper for the voice, but you got to do it in order to get that vibe that you need, whatever you got to do to get that record done, you know, to get the sound that you need, to get the emotion that you need, to get the vibe that you need on the record. So in my opinion, that's the biggest difference. You know, the vocal coach focuses on the technical part, and the vocal producer, we focus strictly on how the stuff is feeling. Obviously, we want it to sound right, but we're just focused on the vibe.
And if you're a vocal producer at your level, you know enough about vocal coaching, right? But that's not the main focus. The main focus is how to get that emotion in that vocal and have it connect to somebody. You're getting a performance that connects
absolutely
to somebody.
Yes, we're getting a performance, and you're absolutely right. We know enough about the technical things. So if I know that I have a singer who you know, they kind of get tired and burn out after maybe 45 minutes of singing, then I know that I need to go on them a little bit lighter and also suggest to them, point them in the direction of what they learned from their vocal coach in regards to their warming up. So if it's a kid, you know, it's kind of like, man, you need to make sure you warm up before you come in the studio, you know, so that your voice is warm, so that we're just not banging away at those vocal cords. And then next thing you know, they're burnt out before we even get halfway through the record.
Right.
Kuk, let's say you're doing a session and you're not getting the feel and the vibe and the emotion. What are some techniques that you would use in that situation that you can share with us?
If I'm not getting the vibe and the, you know, for the most part, if we've been banging away at it for a little while, my biggest thing is, the first thing I do is we step away from it. I was like, I'll be like, you know, come out of the booth. Let's step away from it. Step away from it for a second, kind of rethink it, you know, maybe go outside, do some other things, you know, depending on who's there. Maybe we play some ping pong, but just kind of get our mind off of it, because it's all about the emotion. So, you know, when a singer is in the booth and they're not actually nailing it, they kind of feel like it's like a quarterback. They feel like they're going into quicksand. You know, he keeps throwing, you know, interceptions. He feels like he's going into quicksand, and things just progressively get worse. And the last thing we want to do is let them psychologically get messed up, and then that's going to start to affect their voice, and then that way, then we're on to another day.
Right.
How often do you say to yourself, I've got this as good as I'm going to get it. I'll fix it later. I'll tune it later. I'll move it around and shift the timing and the feel. Do you have a tolerance for that, or is it vary from person to person?
Not for me. My whole goal is to make sure, because the way I approach a vocal, it's all about capturing magic. It's all about the performance being magical. So it's not fixing something later. I want to make sure that I capture it so that it's authentic. Because, I mean, I can create it within the tools, but you know, anybody can do that, you know, but not everybody can capture magic. So the special thing becomes having the ear, having the sensitivity and to knowing that something magical just happened.
If you were recording yourself, how would you do that for yourself? Like a lot of our audience records themselves. How can they get themselves up and police themselves? It's hard, right?
You know, it is very hard to be, what's the word, objective?
Objective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's hard to be objective. And that's why I think, that's one of the reasons why I think me as a vocal producer, I was able to carve out a lane. You know, is I'm really fortunate. The artists that I work with, they realize that they finally had a point person for their performance. Because what was happening was, and it still happens a little bit, a lot of times the labels or whatever, or maybe even the producer that's actually hired to do the record to do the job or who wrote the record will sometimes put the artist in with an engineer. You know, the producer of the record will just kind of go, man, okay, just do me a favor. I'll be down in the studio in a little bit. Just have him or have her sing, you know, sing what they do, get a bunch of information, and we'll chop it up later on. But yeah, you know, that I think for me, I was able to carve out a niche because, you know, the artist realized I've got a point person who is not worried about the kick, the snare, the you know, how hot the 808 is or how hard the track is knocking. This person's worried about how my performance comes off and how it translates and if we're actually getting a great performance. Because at the end of the day, that's all it's about. It's not about, you know, of course we need a great song, but it's that artist's performance that's going to live on forever.
One of the things that because I've seen you at work a number of times over the course of how long we've known each other, and you tend to work in momentum. Like, you get a rhythm going with that particular artist, and yeah. you're about as physically involved. You're actually sometimes more physically involved than they are. You're very active and so on and so forth. And what I found was you made an analogy to a quarterback. And I found that there's a sports kind of metaphor to where you're doing. You're both coach and quarterback, and mm-hmm. they get to be kind of the running back. And you're calling mm-hmm. the play and giving them the ball, and they can find the hole and go for it. And what I think mm-hmm. I saw was that trust happens. And yes. then they just start and you're actually directing like a director yeah. or like a quarterback, yes. and they're just reacting and not thinking a lot. They're just yeah. giving it to you. Is that a fair way to describe it?
That's a perfect way to describe it, because what's happening is, and I always say this, like I have a protege that I've been training as a vocal producer, and that's one of the key things that I've said to this person is that, listen, you don't give them a lot of time to think, because if we give them a lot of time to think, then they won't operate out of the emotion or the vibe. If they start thinking about it, then that sends them down the rabbit hole of maybe things that have been going on before they even got to the studio. It's like I'm creating a world and an atmosphere to where the only thing that they have to think about is how they feel about this particular, these lyrics and this record. So it's, you know, I like being involved in letting them see my excitement. My excitement when I'm producing isn't made up. It's true passion for what I'm doing. Like, a lot of times the artist will go, man, why did you laugh after that? I go, because it's so damn hot. Like, that's amazing, you know, and it excites me. So when I'm that way, when I'm excited and passionate about what I'm doing as a vocal producer and know that we're connecting, they get excited. They're like, man, we're, you know, what's going on here? They feel like, you know, it's lightning in a bottle.
The other hallmark of a number of hallmarks about you that I find interesting is the breadth of the artists that you work with. Mm. Big pop, urban, adult, yeah. hip hop. You've obviously written some big hits as well too. Sometimes because the level of stars that you work with, you know, take Rihanna for instance, you're defined by that relationship in some ways, but it's really broad. You can go from Shakira to Cher to Justin Bieber to rappers to, I can't tell you the number of engineers that we've had on and or producers. And if your name comes up, they'll go, oh yeah, he worked on my artist record or so on and so forth. And that happens a lot. Is there some partition in your brain that you have to do if you're doing one genre versus another genre, or is it kind of the same process for each?
There is, for me, there is no partition, because magic is magic. Mm-hmm. Passion is passion. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when it can be magic and passion in country, it's magic and passion in rap. It's magic and passion in pop. It's magic and passion in R&B. It's vibe. So, you know, for me, the only thing that I have to make sure that I do is that I'm approaching the partition happens only in how I respond and interact with each artist, because everybody's different. It's like I have kids, you know, I've got five kids, but even though they're my kids, they're all different. So I have to respond and talk to each one a different way. So, you know what I mean? So it's the same thing with the artist. We, you know, it's a different communication level and a communication skill with each one.
So if you got a rapper and they have a style and a way you do things, you have to be able to speak to them in their language and get to that passion, the same as if you got a vocalist that does something else. So there are, you have to have different shadings skill-wise per who you're doing, but it all comes back to getting the magic.
It all comes back to magic, absolutely, 100%. You know, the communication skills, I gotta do that anyway with whoever's in the building. But once they go in that booth, once they're on the other side of that glass, it's all about vibe and magic, yep. That's it.
Hey, Kuk, do you still have a preference to engineer your own productions? Are you still doing that? I haven't seen you work in a couple of years.
Oh, absolutely. That's the only way I'll have it. You know, I think this past year I tried it maybe once or twice. No, I don't like it at all, because what happens is no one can dictate the pace of a set. No one knows the pace of a session better than I do as the vocal producer. Like, because when that artist is on the other side of glass, I feel everything that they're feeling. I can feel when they're up, I can feel when they're down, I can feel when they're kind of midstream. So if I have a person in between that and we're cutting something, I need to go back to the B section, I don't need to go, yo, go back to the B section, and then I gotta wait for them to register, respond, stop, you know.
Do you have a favorite vocal chain? That's what everybody wants to know. Do you have a favorite vocal chain, and when would you vary from that favorite vocal chain?
So yes, I do have my go-to vocal chain. Do you want me to tell you what it is or
oh,
not?
Oh yeah. Yeah, that's why we're here, man.
Yeah. That's the money shot. If this was porn, this would be the money shot.
Yeah, there with a plug-in.
Yeah, you know, and I think it's a pretty standard. You know, on the level that we're working in, I think it's pretty standard. You know, it's a C800, the Sony C800, the TubeTech CL1B, and the Neve 1081 mic pre. You know, I think. You know, when I first came into the game, my cousin Tricky Stewart was the one that hit me up to the importance of gear. You know, he said, listen, you know, it's very simple, you know, and it registered right away. It was like, listen, there's a reason why that might cost $10,000 or $15,000 or $20,000. Think about it. Like, if it, you know, it sounds a certain way, and that's why it costs so much. So that's for what we're doing, that's what you want to be using.
Would you change if you were doing a rapper?
You know, I have changed. It depends on the voice. You know, for the most part, everything that's out now, like the records that we're doing, everything has a really sort of bright cutting sound. So the C800 is pretty universal in capturing that. So, but if, you know, if it's a lighter voice, that's what I'm definitely going to use. But if it's something that needs body, you know, like a rapper, you know, I would definitely swap out to maybe a Elam 251 or maybe even a 87, something that's warmer.
So are there in your process, whether it is during or post or whatever engineering, are there plugins that you utilize in your skill set?
Yeah, absolutely. So in my tracking phase, the tracking phase is very simple. I keep it really simple with, you know, I just use the Renaissance 6-band EQ, and I just boost a little high end on it. And, you know, obviously auto-tune, if the artist is used to using auto-tune, I won't print the auto-tune. We're just singing through it and monitoring through it. And then also, as far as like reverb and stuff like that, I'll just use the regular R-verb, you know, medium-sized room, and a ping-pong delay, you know, quarter, eighth delay, just to give it some space in the artist's headphones so it sounds like they're actually in a mix as opposed to it being dry. And, you know, every now and then you'll come across an artist that wants that signal completely dry. You know, singer, you know, sometimes, you know, Jessie J, she doesn't like a lot of reverb or a lot of delay and stuff. She definitely doesn't like auto-tune, which is fine, you know, but, you know, I'm just saying that to show the difference. You know, some artists, they just need to hear it clean. Mm-hmm. so they can.
Oh no, I'm sorry. And what do you monitor with in terms of? Do you have a preference in terms of headphones, and what do you listen to as reference speakers?
In the control room, yeah. It's always NS10s.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, for me, NS10s are the only thing that gives me a true signal of what that voice, what the vocal is. It's very true. You know, it translates very true.
And headphones?
Headphones, there's a, I can't remember the name of it, but they're Sony. They're an older pair of Sony headphones.
Listen, I have listened to an older pair of Sonys for my life and compared them against other things.
Yeah,
And I listen to an Audio-Technica set all the time. But those Sonys were just they were both true and warm and had punch. I don't know how they combined all that, but it was...
Yeah.
Right.
They're perfect. They didn't have a sense of enhanced low end or high end. They for me, for my ears, they sound like I'm listening to the NS10s. You know, so if I'm in some cases, sometimes we're I've recorded albums like when we're on the road, and I've actually had to. We're all in the same room, so I've had to actually track with my headphones on. And, you know, after tracking, if you're tracking a whole record with headphones on, your ears tend to get a little fatigued. So with those headphones, they're a perfect balance. So I can take those off and then start comping right away, as opposed to some headphones that have enhanced low end or enhanced high end. My ears are fatigued. So when I take my headphones off, I got to wait like 15 minutes just for my ears to readjust to the natural sound of the speakers.
So an environmental question. So yeah. I know that sometimes your artists or companies or managers or whoever it may be will reach out to you to prepare somebody for live stuff, for touring. So do you get them prepared in the studio or in the live environment, or where do you do your work with them for that?
Well, it's a combination. Sometimes it starts out in the studio, because what we're doing is we'll pre-record a lot of the background vocals, so that those things are there. So we're in the studio and we're duplicating the backgrounds that are on the record, but we're doing them looser. So that and we're also doing that stuff to recorded versions of the song. So like the band will be in rehearsal, we'll record it, and then we'll do the live background vocals on top of that. So we're starting there, and then when we get to the live performance, then it's I've had instances where I actually function as a vocal coach. So I'm getting the artist ready to perform, so that's when I'm focusing on the technical side of their voice, you know, getting them to warm up properly, all those things.
Kuk, a minute ago you mentioned comping. A lot of people get confused about comping, and in the wrong hands it can be not quite what you expect, you know. What's your philosophy on comping, and how would you go about teaching someone how to comp a vocal?
I would say, from my perspective, I would say keep it simple in how you mentally prepare for it. So what I mean by that is, even though you know that you want to capture a lot of information, meaning in your playlist, so you have a bunch of different versions, even though you know you're doing that, you still want to approach the record from top to bottom, to where the stuff that you're at, when you move on from a section, you know that that's mainly your magical one. So that when you go to the next section and you're hearing that one back from before, it's not one that's out of tune, or it's not one that doesn't have the right vibe on it. It has the vibe and everything, and you can just move on.
But you will work on sections.
You'll build that way through to the end of the record.
You will work on sections. You won't work on the whole song, though.
Absolutely, yeah. I'll never sing a record from top to bottom, because you just can't focus. Like, this is another thing that, you know, my cousin Tricky Stewart taught me early on in this, and he said, listen, we're in the detail business. And when you say that to me, like, we're in the detail business, that means we're looking at everything, every breath, every downbeat, where words are falling on downbeats and stuff like that. So you capture whatever, you know, it's maybe 2-3 lines at a time, and it's whatever the artist is comfortable with. Some artists need to get 2 lines at a time, especially if it's really vibey, you know, a vibey line or something like that. Maybe you just need to focus on that line until you get that line right. But it's not about how fast you can get a record done. It's about the quality of it, you know, the quality, and if that vibe is there.
And you know what? I want to ask you and Dave a question. This is an observation I make from the show, and I'm curious what you think too. And what Kuk has said today, I see, maybe it's not a movement, but I see more and more of the best in their particular space really making the recording process much more simple. Not having tons of layers, not necessarily having tons of gear and software, trying to get from the moment to the truth without a whole lot of stuff. Is that fair to say from you guys' perspective?
Absolutely. I would agree with you 100% because it's you know, we had that run where music was so technical and so filled up and, you know, just a block of sound. But, you know, people really are like, you can watch everybody that listens to the records, and at least a lot of the new records that are out now and a lot of the records that I've done with Rihanna. There's not a lot of information there. It's just great feeling there. And that's what everybody's responding to. Yeah.
You know, it's weird, Kuk and Herb, it's like, as kids, the records we fall in love with have warts and mistakes and are very simple. And then when we get into a position where we can make records ourselves, we do the opposite. We try to sanitize them and we try to add more and more and more. And simpler is always better, right?
Yes, absolutely. It is.
I got a question for you. It's about time, right? the guys that I came along with, Ed C and the guys, they taught me never use words like pitch or flat or sharp when you're working with a singer, because it psychologically causes them to focus on the pitch and not the performance. Is that a concept you adhere to yourself?
No, I don't adhere to that. I always use flat and sharp and pitch and stuff like that, because if you don't, you know, especially nowadays that everything that we hear has auto-tune on it, or it's either melodyned. So if I don't use those terms, the artist really doesn't know where I need them to go. So I mean, I say it a million times, like, man, let's get that one more time. I'll literally say, let's get that one more time for pitch. And they know it's either flat or sharp. You know, they know instinctively or internally. Or sometimes I'll just go, man, get that one more time, you're flat.
Well, and also in the style that you do it, because in reality, I remember the first time we had you on the show, and I had Kuk at lunch in Santa Monica about 46 seconds later, because what I found fascinating is that Kuk, as much as he is a vocal producer, he's also an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you relate to artist as an artist, and there's a kinsmanship there and a trust there. So they speak and trust you as one of theirs.
Yeah.
And you get a certain leeway. And then the other thing, that it also cuts across, again, so many ages and genres and different kinds of things, because artistry understands artistry.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Artistry understands people who know how to handle artistry. Some of us who are on the business side, they like our relationship. You know, there's just a thing that we have, and it's all based on trust and stuff. When you're sharing with them, what I've learned from watching you is that when you say sharp or flat, whatever the case may be, they understand their correction.
Exactly.
They go, okay, cool. I need to do this, or whatever the case may be. So in Kuk world, which has been a number of things, back in the day, there was some talent stuff and some judging stuff. You've always cared about academia and trying to make sure you bring people along, or at least give them a shot.
Absolutely.
I know from your foundation and your work with folks in Atlanta and other things we're doing, education. One of the cool things that you're doing is you've done a series, the first of many, about vocal production, right? Describe it. Give us the title and everything.
The title is called Both Sides of the Glass. And, you know, it was something that I definitely am passionate about. And showing up and coming vocal producers that it's really important. The reason why I called it Both Sides of the Glass is because you got to have an understanding of how it feels to be on the other side of the glass as an artist, to be able to communicate, to be able to get the things that you need them to do. You have to know how they're feeling. You know, you got to know the things that they're going through mentally and emotionally on that other side of the glass.
Chongor shot it. We partnered with him, with Hal Leonard. It's been a labor of love, and we started having this discussion a long time ago. Let's show a quick snippet, can we?
Yes, let's do it.
Cool, roll it.
So, let's get back at it. Moan.
Hey.
Hey.
That's a lot more present.
Yeah, it is, right. Yeah, you can't beat it. Thanks so much. Sorry about that. Thanks for your patience there.
Of course.
All right, so now we're at the point to where we've gotten rid of all the glitches. We're actually going to jump into this session. A lot of times people try to figure out what's the best way. Where should I start in the song? Should I start in the verse? Should I start in the bridge? And a lot of times the vocalist, they'll go, well, where should we start? You should have that already figured out in your mind, the best place to start the record, so that when they ask you, they sense your confidence that you have everything figured out, as opposed to going, I don't know, let me see. You want to make sure that you've done, this goes back to what we talked about earlier, make sure that you've done all of your homework so that every question that comes up, you have the best answer for it. And if you don't have the answer for it, you want to make sure that you convey your answer in a way that promotes confidence as opposed to weakness or uncertainty. Let me say it like that. You want to always seem certain about every decision that you're making or every answer that you're putting forth for the artist. Because an artist that's on the other side of the glass is feeding off of your confidence. You are the guy that was chosen to produce this record. So, Simone.
Hey.
You good?
Yeah, man.
All right, so here's what we're going to do. Let's actually start cutting this from the top.
Okay.
I think this will give you, you know, it's just a simple dance record, you know? You've heard it. You know what it is. And let me just play it. I want to check your, let's check your headphone level.
Okay, just sing along?
Yeah, sing along with it and let me know if you need less of anything, more of anything.
Okay.
And we'll go from there. So at this stage of it, once we're about to jump into the record, you're going to play it for the first time for the vocalist so that they can hear what's there. You want to make sure that their headphone level is perfect. What I mean by that, you want to make sure that there's a great blend of music versus her vocal in her ears so that if it's too low, if her vocal is too low or the music is louder than her vocal, she's going to spend the next hour trying to sing on top of that. And she's not focusing on levels. She won't know to tell me. If she doesn't know to tell me, turn it up. She'll spend the next hour and a half trying to sing over that loud music and consequently end up burning her voice out before we even get halfway through the record. So you want to make sure you address all those things, headphone level. So let's do that, Simone. Okay.
So that, for all you guys watching, that is the actual process of Kuk doing what he's doing. That's as real as it gets. He kind of only has one way of doing it. Like, you're not
Absolutely.
A guy who switches up. You produce the way you produce.
No.
We got a couple questions from Facebook fans. Stronger, what do you got?
This first one's from called Alex on the Boards. What is your preference on tuning during tracking for artists that want it? And how aggressive do you have your tuning set?
So what is my opinion on tuning during tracking?
Yeah. So your preference on tuning during tracking and how aggressive do you have the auto-tune during the tracking phase?
I definitely love having auto-tune on it. It's not, and I'm not aggressive. I would probably say the key to if you're having it while you're tracking, definitely don't print it because you want to be able to have the freedom to have things be loose later on, you know, not so perfect. And then when I'm actually using it, it's not aggressive at all. Like you never want to hear glitches unless that's actually what you're going for. But for the most part, for most records, I like for it to feel nice and natural. So and so you can hear some flaws in it.
All right, Chongor, you got another one?
Yep, this one's from Nikita Arcada. Do you have a specific technique you've shown singers, something physical, not mental, that's made a big improvement in their singing?
actually, the main thing is, it's nothing like you're not moving them or anything like that. The main thing is just physically letting them see that you're involved in the production. You know, you're like, when I produce, you see me vibing with the record. You see me directing them. If we need to go high, it's like I'm in whatever the record is doing. That physical, those physical things, them seeing me do that lets them know that I'm with them, as opposed to being the guy that's kind of sitting there like, they're singing their heart out and I'm just sitting there chilling. And I go, yeah, that's hot. Do it one more time. Like, that's more, you know, you're not inciting anything, right. No, any kind of excitement.
Right.
So
here's one of the most important questions of the day, which is, we never can get enough information from you. We need to have you come back and do part yes. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6.
I'm there.
You have been a great fan and supporter of our show. You know how we feel yes. about you. We are amazed at your talent and your humanity, brother. It is just amongst the best. And the other thing I want to do is make sure that I have nothing to do with the divorce that could happen if I don't let you get back to your anniversary, for sure. Kuk, we are huge fans. Thank you for taking the time on this important day. Best to the family, and you'll come back and share with us?
100%. Thank you guys so much for everything. I appreciate you 100%.
Both sides of the glass. Kuk Harrell, he's an amazing guy.
See you, Kuk. Yep.
Talk
See you,
to you, brother. All right, man. Bye-bye.
All right, talk to you.
Take care.
All right, bye-bye. He's one of the best.
I mean, I think he is the best.
Yeah, right.
He's our buddy, you know.
And he's our buddy, too. Yeah. Right, absolutely.
You know, one thing I thought about her while we were talking to Kuk was how he carried himself, and how if I was a singer, which I'm not, mm-hmm. but I thought for a second there, if Kuk produced me, I could sing. Mm-hmm. Because yeah. he's yep. got that, he's just got that confidence. And how do you get confidence? You get confidence through experience. And how do you get experience? Well, you got to put in the hours. He's got thousands and thousands and thousands of hours at solving problems. And so when he gets in front of someone, he doesn't have a crack in his armor of confidence. And when you see that, and that personality comes through, it's pretty clear how he gets his great performances out of his artists. But in everything in life, I think that's the formula. Think about it. See you next week.